Hello and welcome to East Brentwood Presbyterian Church, located in the greater Nashville metropolitan area. I'm Nate Strasser, music director here at EBPC. We are super excited that you've come to join us today because in case you haven't checked your Presbyterian planning calendar, today is Intercultural Sunday, the third Sunday of May. In preparing for worship today, we asked ourselves, what does an intercultural community look like? Hopefully, our worship service today will reflect our understanding. A community where structures, our everyday interactions, are defined by mutuality, respect, equality, understanding, acceptance, justice, diversity, and celebration. Speaking of community, before we enter into worship today, I wanted to speak to you about Realm, our app that we're using to connect everyone in our congregation with what's going on in the church. You can do all kinds of things on this app. You can connect with small groups, coordinate activities, RSVP for meetings and other events going on around the church, and even manage your giving. So if you haven't downloaded the app already, all you have to do is just pause me for a second and go get your phone. I'll wait. Okay, so now that you have your phone, go to Realm Connect in your app store. And all you have to do is use the same login that you use to create your account online. And if you haven't created your account quite yet, all you have to do is find an invite link in your email. If you didn't get an invite link, let Shauna, Lindsay, John, or me know, and we'll get you all set up. Okay, so now that you're into Realm, I wanted to introduce you to one of the really cool features called the prayer wall. So, to get to the prayer wall, you click the three little lines you'll see in the upper left-hand corner. Go to Groups, then scroll to Find Groups. Touch Community, and then find the group that says Prayer Wall. After opening the prayer wall, request to join the group. Once you're added, you'll be able to post prayer requests and pray for other members of our congregation. It's a really great feature. So thank you so much for listening. And if you have any questions at all about Realm, please let us know. We'll get you straightened out. Now sit back and relax and enjoy today's worship service.
We are confident and united in our love for God. You, Lord, are a shield around us, the one who lifts up our heads. When we are united in you, we find each other's humanity. It is God who sustains us, and it is in God that we find our identity. Dear God, the scriptures attest, you love each of us as if there were only one of us to love. And so we come to you in that unconditional love, grateful beyond words. We are here together as a reminder that your family is big and diverse in every way and more inclusive than we have ever been courageous enough to recognize. So as we join our voices and our prayers and our speaking and listening, come to us and remind us that in Jesus Christ we belong to you and to one another forever, in Christ's name. God of grace and glory, we confess that we have many faults and yet do not take action to correct them. There are issues we can't seem to get past for reasons that feel complex and daunting. We fall short of who you call us to be. When we ignore your call to honor the dignity of others, forgive us. When we deny the promises of your grace to ourselves or others, forgive us. Help us to remember that all lives are precious. Remind us that while our mistakes shape us, they do not have to define us. Friends, believe the good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Brother, let me be your servant, and let me be as Christ to you. Pray that I may have the grace to let you be my servant too.
It seems that in this past year, we have all been on a journey, lots of journeys. And along the way, we have realized that a lot of the knowledge that we had and many of the practices that we observed as we made it through life are in need of a reset. And yet, thankfully, we get a chance to keep on walking and learning and relearning, and a chance along the way to walk with others to help us find our way. Now, I'll rest the oversimplifying the story between Philip and the Ethiopian eunuchs that before us in Acts 8, 26 through 40 to say it is a road trip story. But this is how the story goes. Then an angel of the Lord said to Philip, get up and go toward the south to the road that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. It's a wilderness road. So Philip got up and went. And now there was an Ethiopian eunuch, a court official of the Candace, queen of the Ethiopians. And he was in charge of her entire treasury. And he had come to Jerusalem to worship. But being that he was a castrated human male, in that time and place, he would not have been allowed to be a part inside of the temple worship. So he would have been outside and not able to participate. But he was a powerful person of means, representing a queen. So likely he could have had access to the rare scroll of the prophet Isaiah, which were not readily available in that time, showing that the eunuch must have had a great deal of thirst and questioning going on. And now where we pick up the scripture, the eunuch is returning home, seated in his chariot, reading from the scroll of the prophet Isaiah. Then the Spirit said to Philip, go over to this chariot and join it. So Philip ran up to it and heard him reading the prophet Isaiah. Philip asked, do you understand what you're reading? The eunuch replied, how can I, unless someone guides me? And he invited Philip to get in and sit beside him. Now, the passage of the scripture that he was reading was this: like a sheep he was led to the slaughter, and like a lamb silent before its shearer, so he does not open his mouth. In his humiliation, justice was denied him. Who can describe his generation? For his life is taken away from the earth. The eunuch asked Philip, about whom, may I ask you, does the prophet say this? About himself or about someone else? Then Philip began to speak, and starting with the scripture, he proclaimed to him the good news about Jesus. Now, reading of the encounter between Philip and Nathanael, Philip and the Ethiopian eunuch on the wilderness road, I can't help but to remember my encounter with Theobald. It was February 2020, just before the world went down on lockdown, and I was walking about a 300-mile trip, a Camino, with my son and a guide across the southern tip of Africa to its southernmost tip. We had been walking daily anywhere from 9 to 18 miles a day for several weeks, and we were less than a mile away from that famed destination there at the confluence of the Atlantic and the Indian Ocean, there at the southernmost tip of Africa, where shipwrecks frequently happen, where there I was to take a rock and I was to throw it into the swirling seas. You know, I had been given this rock by a South African who had sent us on our way with these words: while you walk, I want you to think about all of the things that you need to let go of, and let this rock represent those things. And when you get to the tip of Africa, I want you to throw your rock into the sea. So I was less than a mile away from that place where I was going to throw regrets and to toss the rock of my tendency to be judgmental into the sea when I met Theobald, who stopped and said, I think God told me I was supposed to meet you. Well, it turned out Theobald was a park ranger who had driven out to a remote place to meet a fellow park ranger for some work. And while waiting for the colleague to show, Theobald took a cat nap, during which he would come to tell us was when God visited him and told him to be on the lookout for three people who he was supposed to meet and who he was supposed to tell them about his life. Now, driving back to the remote road, Theobald passed by the man who had been our host the night before, who asked the ranger if he had seen three people, some important American and his son, and a young dorminee, a pastor walking with them on the road, which no doubt piqued the park ranger's interest. So Theobald, seeing three people, came up alongside us and again said, I think you are the one God wants me to meet. God wants me to tell you my testimony. And so we heard of a horrific car accident that Theobald had survived, of the conversion in the hospital to give his life over to God's work, of how his work as a park ranger, he has the opportunity to meet people from every walk of life, rich, poor, black, white, brown people who in remnants that once stratified South Africa still seldom have little reason to interact with one another. We heard of how God is using Theobald to be the great connector among this division, and of how God is using him in a land where people still struggle with the trauma of colonialism, of how God is using him to be a lighthouse of hope, and of how he is convinced through his work and encounters with all of these people coming from such different experiences, he can bring hope and healing to South Africa, and from this tip, in the southernmost tip of Africa, that this healing and this hope can resonate up through the continent of Africa. And that is what God wanted me to share with you, he said to me. He didn't ask anything of me, but I'm telling you now about Theobald, this lighthouse of hope at the tip of Africa, whose quiet mission it is to bring healing to a complicated land that the church has helped, but also helped to complicate and harm. And all he asked for me was to listen and to pray for him, which we did. And maybe now that you know of him too, you will pray for him as well. And then I walked on to the water's edge and I hurled my rock of regret and of judgment into the sea. Now Philip's sending to meet up with the eunuch in his chariot was precipitated not by knowing and of some knowledge to impart, but by a question that's coming from the eunuch that is in search of answering. Now the scholar Willie James Jennings, in his commentary on the book of Acts, paraphrases this question: who is this person in pain and suffering, humiliation and shame, which Isaiah asked? When Philip told the eunuch about Jesus, the lamb that was slaughtered, and the one who did not open his mouth, he was giving not an answer but a testimony. His answer was not a matter of conveying knowledge. It was a witness to an encounter which helped the eunuch to make sense of what was already present inside the eunuch through the presence of God. Now, if I understand what is going on in this story, Philip's role was not to present the eunuch with all of this knowledge of the promises of Israel. The eunuch was reading the promises there in the scroll as he went along in the chariot. Instead, Philip found himself confronted with a man who had already been confronted by God, and his role is of a fellow traveler in God, not as an imparter of knowledge, leading me to understand the focus of this story is not so much about Philip's knowledge or Philip's faithfulness, but on God's presence. I like what Willie Jennings explains here. The eunuch asked the right question, one that is like a prayer that God will answer. Now the body of God will be seen where no one could have imagined or dared to look at the place of humiliation and pain on a eunuch's chariot. God has come for the eunuch precisely in his difference and exactly in the complexities of his life. He matters not because he is close to worldly power and thus a more appealing pawn as a tool of evangelization. He simply matters. And he's being brought close. He will no longer be brought far, be far from home, for God has broken the connection between the identity and the destiny, between definition and determination, and inserted a new trajectory. In the encounter, God became known not in knowledge that flowed from Philip to the other, but in the interrelationship of questions and testimony, in the interrelationships of one with another. And maybe that same can be said in the encounter with Theobald and me, as this encounter continues to work on me and perhaps on him as well. Now, there would have been a time years ago when encountering someone who comes from very different experiences from myself, or who expressed their faith very differently, the barrier that I would put up would be this, let's call it a knowledge thing. Do I know enough about who and what I think they are? And what do I think they need to be or should be? Is there a knowledge that I can impart? The barrier, a result of privilege and power. But nowadays, at this stage of my life, in my journey through life, I'm trying to lean into this sense of what is going on in the wilderness road, whether it is from Jerusalem to Gaza, or on the road near the tip of Africa, or in the experience so many of us had in our connection and encounters with others in Guatemala, which we'll show you more just now, and you'll have a chance to hear a testimony. But in all of these, it is this that I am suggesting, that as we walk together, we may be open to what Willie Jennings calls an extravagant appreciation of our creatureliness, woven in difference, and destined for communion with the divine life. Only, he says, an ecclesial practice of difference can make intelligible and redemptive any reflection on and process of change that would draw us ever deeper into God's love and God's power. And I really like those words. And I'm fairly certain that I agree with them almost 100% of the time. Of how they would look in practice, somewhat escapes me. But in these days, there is a lot to learn. And there's quite frankly a lot to unlearn and confess. But such an encounter with the other and with the divine life and with those who are different than ourselves does not require one. This is what I want to share with you. It does not require one to take a long road trip to Africa or to Jerusalem or down to Guatemala. Journeys of transformation can be shared wherever we may be if we are attentive to the work of the Spirit. The Holy Spirit leads us to new places, wherever we may be, because all of these folks are wherever we are. LGBTQ, black, white, brown, from here, from there, migrant, immigrant, Jew, Palestinian, urban, rural, rich, poor, in all there is the opportunity to experience the Spirit of God at work. Ooh, yeah, this past year, the church and all of us have all been on journeys. We may decide there is a need for a reset. And like my friend on the road, Diavol, perhaps God is using us to be a lighthouse of hope through our work and encounters with all who come from different experience than our own, so that together we can bring hope and healing. We keep going, you see. And the opportunity before us is that others travel with us, helping us to find our way home to God. Amen. Thank you.
I had the opportunity on our last visit to the Ketchi Patin in March of 2020, before COVID spread, to share a hug from our presbytery with Pastor Juan Andreas. I told him that we in the Presbytery of Middle Tennessee grieved with him the loss of his wife, Patrocinia, at the age of 39, which had occurred since our last visit the year before. Patrocinia lived in Valley Nuevo. She lived under the same stars, the same sun and moon, and the same time zone as Middle Tennessee. She was the president of the Presbyterian Women and a pastor's wife. Unlike 90% of the other men and women in the Ketchi Mayan Patan, she could read and write Spanish, the equivalent of a third grade education. She was a health promoter, the highest certification in healthcare obtainable by the Mayan Ketchi. But through no fault of her own, except that she was born at a latitude 20 degrees south of us, her life was very different from ours. To say she had a hard life barely describes her experience. In her lifetime, her homeland, the Patin, was deforested. This deforestation led to flooding 6 months a year and drought the other 6 months. Recent hurricanes destroyed crops and leveled villages to the ground. The land on which they live cannot grow enough food to sustain them. Employment options are thin, since most are monolingual and cannot speak, read, or write Spanish. The palm oil plantations are hiring but pay only 60 cents an hour, which is not sustainable even by Guatemalan standards. As a child, Patrocinia witnessed firsthand the Guatemalan Civil War and the military's attempted genocide of the Mayan race. Patrocinia's village is in the middle of a subtropical swamp with smoke-filled houses of dirt floors, bug-infested thatch roofs, no electricity, and no plumbing. The local water is not safe to drink. There were no schools for her 12 children. The burdens of her 20-degree latitude difference shortened her life to 39 years. But during a daily Bible study, during one of my 8 trips to the Patin, she told the group she never felt the absence of God. How many of us living in our cozier 36 degrees latitude can say the same? Nathaniel asked, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip responded, "Come and see." For me personally, my trips to the Ketchi Patin have transformed me into seeing God's providence through Patrocinia's eyes. For me, Nathaniel's question, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" is transformed into the question, "Can anything good become of a trip to Guatemala?" In memory of Patrocinia, Philip's answer remains, "Come and see."
Listen, listen, while the storm in your heart is raging. Listen, listen, listen. Listen, listen to the echoes of martyrs playing. Listen, listen, listen. Listen. Brothers and sisters, listen, listen, listen. I swear we'll never find a way to where we're going. All alone, don't take your eyes off the road. Can you hear the bell? Listen. sisters, listen, listen, listen. I swear we'll never find a way to where we're going. All alone, don't take your eyes off the road. Can you hear the bells ring out? Speak up.
Let new life enter in, let joy.
Singing.